An die CEO auf der Hilfsgemeinschaft der Blinden und Sehschwachen Österreichs, AKA, die Austrian Association Supporting the Blind and Visually Impaired. We are a non-profit organization founded in 1935. So that means we are one of the oldest one in Austria. We have 4,300 visually impaired and blind members and more than 2,000 other members. So we are the biggest one in Austria. And we are offering free membership and are financed only from private donations. That means we are not influenced by the state or the parties or something like that. We have about 100 employees in three places in Austria, and we are working, as you can see it in the slides that will fall, on different levels and in different organizations, nationwide, European wide, and worldwide. What are our tasks? Our tasks are information and awareness. What is a very important part of our work? Lobbying. Lobbying means working on Brussels level, for example. I was, for example, in the high-level experts group on artificial intelligence at the Commission of the European Union, where we had this paper on trustworthiness of AI in the European Union and the strategy for AI in the European Union. And I brought in the perspective of the DPOs and persons with disabilities in general. Then, the work on the ground is we have a retirement home, we have member services. That means our members can come to us. We support them when they sue, for example, when they want to have some assistive technologies, when they want to have financing for assistive technologies and all these stuff. And my main work is accessibility. Accessibility in the field of information and communication technology, especially for persons with blindness or visual impairness, but not only. I'm working in my work as a advocate for persons with disabilities, for persons for blind and visual impaired persons. I mentioned in an early stage that it's necessary to work together with other organizations that are representing other forms of blindness, and also working together with politicians, policymakers, universities, and so on and so on. How we do it, and how we see the world, I hope you can hear it now. So how we see the world. So that means we don't want to be in this. We want to see it in a little bit in a different way. I hope you have seen all the video now, and it's not gone away. Hello. Hello.
Video. Yes.
It's okay. Yes. Okay. Yeah. It's not. I think it's not a normal video, because when you look at this video, you can see we look at the world in a little bit different way. We want that the people that are under our umbrella can work independently and as an we say normal person. Yeah? And so we don't want to have these donations from the social part of the world that are saying, okay, these poor people that are blind, we have to help them. Blind people and visually impaired people connect as normal peoples when they get the real support. How we do this? We are working on a national level, for example, in the Austrian umbrella of organizations for persons with disabilities, the Austrian Disability Forum. We're working in the Austrian standards. We're doing national projects on a European level, for example, in the European Disability Forum, where you have, I think, Alejandro in the afternoon. We are working in the EASPD, that's the European Association for Service Providers for Persons with Disabilities. We are working in the European Standardizations, in the high level group on artificial intelligence. As I mentioned it before, we are doing Erasmus Horizon and assistive AAL projects on an European scope. And we're working also on an international level in the International Association of Accessibility Professionals with C3ICT and enabling in the ITU on ISO. And one project which I want to mention is Zero Project with the Essel Foundation, which is an Austrian-based organization, respectively, initiative that brings together about 4,600 players in the world of not only ICT, but mainly in the world of ICT and persons with disabilities every year in Vienna at the United Nations Center here. Not next year because of COVID, but hopefully in 2022 again, where we have about 800,000 people coming together from all parts of the world, exchanging ideas, policies, and practices to be able to blueprint them and so on, to exchange how they do it in their countries and perhaps to transfer it to other countries. And we're working together with Access Israel. Access Israel is a big organization in Israel, the biggest one in Israel, which has, in the meantime, worldwide impact. They are doing also big conferences with more than 1,000 people normally every year. And they have a network of several hundred other organizations in, all over the world, especially in Africa and in Asia. And in the Americas, so in the Spanish-speaking countries too. And how we do this, we are supporting certification like the CPEC or the WAS from IWAP. That means certification in accessibility in a technical way and on the level of a manager, for example. The Certified Web Accessibility Expert here in Austria, that was an initiative I launched several years ago together with the Chamber of Commerce here in Austria, where we made a person-centered certification for persons working in the field of accessibility, so that when you are an employer and you want to hire people that are fit in accessibility, you can be sure that these people are really have really a deep knowledge in the field of accessibility, and that is proven by the CAAE. And on the other hand, we have a product certification. That means we certify websites in the field of WCAG 2.1 AA. That means in the field of accessibility, that's the Web Accessibility Certificate Austria, the WACA.at. You can have a look on the website, but unfortunately, I think it's only in German. Then we are in several projects that are only examples. The Web Accessibility Directive, Decision Support Environment, the Watcher project, which is now for 3 years on the stage, which should help the Commission to decide which products they want to have to support the implementation of the Web Accessibility Directive in throughout Europe. And one very interesting project product that we have is we want to make a syllabus for persons with visual impairments to be 3D print operator and to produce, for example, 3D models for prosthetics. And we train, for example, the United Nations staff here in Vienna. And the third part of our work is we are going to conferences, to many conferences like the International Conference on Computers Helping People with Special Needs, founded by Klaus Miesenberger here in Linz in Austria at the University in Linz, or the AAATE, or in America the CSUN, for example. But it's only the only examples. There are a few more conferences where we are going to. What is visual impairment? A visual impaired person is someone who, despite optimal correction, cannot achieve a normal vision. That means that the visual acuity is reduced and the field of vision is limited. When we're speaking about the figures, that means from 30% to 5%, we have a visual impairment. severe visual impairment from 5% to 2%, and legally blind you are when you have a visual acuity under 2%. That refers, for example, in Austria to about the visual impairment, the blindness, the legal blindness in Austria, for example, is in the figure is about 8 to 10,000 persons. When you're speaking about visual impaired persons in Austria, we have about 320 to 360,000 persons. That means about 4% of the population is touched by this problem. As I said it before, 318 to 360,000 persons, but the statistics are not really reliable here. Over the age of 60, we are speaking about 10% of the persons that are touched by this impairness. And with increased age, the proportion of the persons with visual impairment rises very, very significantly. When I see it, the numbers that we have in our organization, for example, more than the half of the persons are 65 plus. Causes are premature birth, for example, eye diseases, tumors, accidents, injuries or illnesses. But you have to be aware about the difference. Blind or visually impaired from birth, they have to be treated in a totally different way because they have other needs. A person who is blind from birth uses, for example. Sorry, this is, for example, Braille. But when I'm not visually impaired from birth, I'm not using Braille because perhaps when I'm old, I am not able to learn Braille when I'm 65 or 70 or 75 or something like that. I need other aids. I need other assistive technologies, for example. And we have sudden blindness, which appears more often than we think about it. That persons become blind within 2 or 3 weeks or 2 or 3 months. A slow transition of a blindness as a middle-aged adult is also another thing. And in old age, visual impairments and blindness is often a result of some kind of illness or, for example, diabetes. As you can imagine a little bit how it looks like for a person who has a visual impairment, not a blind person. You see our entrance room, for example, here in Vienna, in a normal vision. When you have a macular degeneration, for example, then you see it like this. When you have a retinitis pigmentosa, it looks like this. When you have a diabetic, it looks like this. Glaucoma. And a cataract. What can you do to cope with these problems? You can learn Braille, as I said it before. It's sometimes a little bit different to learn Braille when you're older, even if you, well, especially if you have diabetes, for example, because then you cannot use your fingers to learn Braille. The next problem is the orientation at home and in public spaces. You need help. That means you need a mobility trainer or a trainer who helps you first how to cope with this situation and how to find the nearest and most used ways that you need to go every day, for example, to buy food or something like that. Then how can you use your residual vision if you have, for example, 2.5 or 2 point or 3 point, 3%, sorry, in the point. 3% residual vision. Yeah? How can you use it in your best way? How can you go to networks and how can you find the right person that can help you to cope with your situation? And how can you enhance other senses, touch and hearing, for example? Many persons are replacing their sight sense with hearing and touch. And how can you deal overall with your disability? I want to give you some examples how you can speak with a person who is blind, for example, or is legally blind. never hesitate to offer assistance, because if you sometimes it's necessary to speak with the persons because they are in danger, for example. Offer your arm, and we will take it when we want it. Often it happens that people are waiting in front of the traffic light, and another person is coming and carrying them over the street, even if they don't know, if they don't want to go over the street. And ask, and then do it. Escalators and stairs. Let the person decide what they want to do, and ask them what they want to do. For example. Indicate the seat, for example, when you see a person, a blind person. Tell the person where is the seat and not say, okay, there's a chair. And you can speak to a person with a severe visual impairment in normal loudness. Often it happens that the persons are crying to you when they want to speak with you, because they think if you can't see, you can't hear too. And you should describe what's going on. You can't describe it, and you can't describe it in your normal way. That's not the problem. Communication is everything. If you leave the table of the room, even if you go to the toilet, to the restroom or something like that, announce it and tell it to the person who is sitting in front of you and who is blind. Because they also want to know where you are and when you are coming back. And use the language in a normal way. You can see you later. There is no linguistic taboo, but tell the person what's going on around.